better roll them dice. You never know if it could change your life. Take a chance, you need a wrong or right. You never know if you don't.
I got distracted thinking about it, but because I'm so excited to see what happens with the new artificer. I have been waiting for this for a really, really long time. And so
it's time to start an Eberron campaign.
It's funny because mine is about to wrap after 2 years of running it. I started it because I foolishly believed that fifth edition was going to place a higher priority on Eberron and put out like a campaign setting or an artificer. They had just released sort of, I think, the very first Unearthed Arcana with a artificer in it, when it was still just like a wizard subclass. And foolish young Rob from 3 years ago thought this meant that there was going to be a lot more Eberron content, and as it turns out, there was not. But even though it is too late to make it into my Eberron campaign, I'm still very excited to see what they come up with for the Artificer.
I find it extremely fitting. This inside Eberron joke, there are 12 fifth edition classes. The Artificer will be the 13th. There's a running theme in Eberron of 12 plus 1, mm-hmm. the sort of baker's dozen, mm-hmm. Keith Baker. Yeah, so that's one news. That's next month. Also, the spring release for D&D is going to be a nautical ships, maritime adventures source book of some kind.
I'm not sure if that's going
to be a nautical campaign. Like a published module, or if it's just going to be a regular source book, but it's something to do with the sea. And of course, they're doubling down on Forgotten Realms by releasing non-Sword Coast, non-Northwest.
That's right. We haven't talked about this yet, because this happened literally the day we were recording last time, but Who's His Face talked about how they want to emphasize more of the non-European cultures in Forgotten Realms, which could go either way, I suppose, since traditionally those are not Asia, not Africa, not, you know, the Middle East, and lacking in the sort of cultural depth that we tend to look for when creating new, new fantasy cultures, I suppose.
Well, speaking of creating new fantasy cultures and new worlds, what are we doing today?
That's right. Today we're going to be talking about world building, and this is, of course, Dungeon Master of None, and I am Dungeon Master Rob.
And I'm Dungeon Master Matt.
Yeah, we've done a couple of world building episodes before, and this is a big hobby horse of ours, and it's sort of become like a big function of this podcast, so I hope you like world building, because there's going to be more of it. But we have a specific topic for today, right, Matt?
Hell yeah. Yeah, we've done some general world-building episodes in the past. You're welcome to go look those up. But today, we're going to focus down on one aspect of world-building, which is magic, spellcasting, faiths, gods, the divine, all that shit.
Yeah, and this is particularly exciting for both of us, because both of us are working on one or more new or revised homebrews. And so I know that I've come with some specific sticking points and questions and things to discuss with Matt, and I think Matt has too. So hopefully we can give some sort of general advice, and also you can benefit from our overall experience as we are dealing with this as well.
Are you a god?
As always, the answer to that question, if anybody asks it to you, is yes. If somebody asks you if you're a god, you say yes.
Well, so should we start with gods then, or should we start with magic?
Let's start with gods. I think that in the grand scheme of things, gods, you know, predate or magic often flows from gods. So let's start with talking about faith and deities and general sort of eschatological stuff. Matt, do you have a sort of like a jumping off point for this?
Well, sure. I think my first jumping off point is, again, we're world building with the sort of assumption in mind that you're probably using the Dungeons & Dragons 5th edition rule set. Hopefully most of this stuff will be useful to you if you use something else. But one of the interesting things about fantasy in Dungeons & Dragons in particular is I think it makes, within reason, a pretty broad view of different ways your world could interpret or use the gods. at maybe one far end, like Dark Sun, where the gods don't actually exist and clerics have to draw their power from the elements or evil sorcerer kings. Or you could go to something like the Forgotten Realms, where the gods are very real. There's a lot of them. They meddle in mortal affairs. They come down to Earth all the fucking time. Or you could sort of be somewhere in between where the gods may or may not exist. It's up to your player's interpretation.
Yeah, and I think the path of least resistance for most fantasy games, I guess this is really what we're talking about here, though faith in science fiction can often be really interesting, and maybe we can touch on that later. But the real, like, what it's sort of assumed how things work, unless you're deliberately striking out on your own, is that there's some sort of pantheon. It's a polytheistic society. There's, you know, a dozen gods, possibly even more, all of which your clerics and paladins can draw power from, who are real and often take an interest in the world, but aren't necessarily all powerful. This is sort of the model that most big time fantasy properties took, you know, Lord of the Rings and, you know, Dragonlance and the Forgotten Realms books. You know, generally, you've got, you know, some sort of like list of engaged deities, or less often some sort of like over god with a bunch of less powerful divine entities working for that person. But that's makes the most sense sort of within the existing framework of D&D, where you've got a bunch of domains and different sorts of types of clerics and paladins.
You need a source of power for clerics and paladins.
Right.
And explaining those domains.
Yeah. And the easiest way, I think, again, like I said, the path of least resistance is to have a bunch of gods with certain portfolios, so you can have a god of the forge, or a god of, you know, of nature, or a god of healing or something like that, to keep things simple.
I have 2 points, Rob. I'm interested, 2 general points. I'm interested to see what you think. One, I think one of the best approaches to gods is one taken by Rich Berlew in his comic Order of the Stick, which is kind of a silly parody of D&D, but actually makes a lot of sense, is the gods are very real. You can talk to them via spells, but they can't come to Earth. They can't appear there, and that's why they have clerics or paladins to get the shit they want done, to enact their will on the mortal planes. So I think that's a great approach to this.
Yeah, I agree as well. I think that's, I mean, you want to have an explanation for why the gods don't just hop down and mess with things on a day-to-day basis. And one of the easiest ways is what Rich Berlew says, is that they can't, and that's why they have clerics and paladins. That's what those people are for, which makes perfect sense.
I think one of the through lines in my world building is you often want to create things with why we need adventurers, right? Here are some things that exist, but there's definitely room for heroes, right? You got to have lots of heroes. My second point is I think when building gods and pantheons and things like that, less is more. One of the problems you can run into is if you have 30 different gods and, you know, your players, only one or two of them are ever going to be important to their character, and only one or two are ever going to be really important in a single adventure.
I agree. And this is actually one of my few points of criticism of Eberron, is that there's actually too many different faiths and different types of gods, and that it's really not that many within the grand scheme of things, and it's probably actually less than Forgotten Realms has, but the way that they are all sort of inserted into the framework of Eberron means that it's a little hard to keep track of from a DM's perspective. If you're a player, you can sort of like pick and choose, but on a, you know, as you are moving through the world of Eberron, you're going to have to sort of like know where the Silver Hand is and the Dark Six and, you know, the Light of Adar and then all these, you know, Cults of the Dragon Below and whatnot, and it becomes a little bit difficult to manage. But less, I agree with Matt, less is more. And especially if you're doing your own homebrew, I would encourage you, even if you know all like 1,000 gods of, you know, the infinite planes, whatever place your characters are starting in, maybe limit them to 6, a dozen or so. You know, if they ask about others, you can certainly give it to them, but
You can always go
limited.
To the extreme and, you know, as, for example, the DMG or the old Deities and Demigods books suggest, just have one or two gods.
Yeah. And that's always an option, is there's always one god, an overgod, a general force-like power. There's nothing wrong with that whatsoever. I also think that having clerics and paladins draw their power from an element or an idea is very elegant and... I think should be like emphasized a bit more in the DMG. I think that's a great way to keep things simple. You know, you're a paladin of virtue, you're a paladin of justice, you're a paladin of vengeance, and you draw your power from this sort of idea or your commitment to that virtue in a, you know, sort of a esoteric religious type way, you know.
Caveat to our less is more is I really do love the divine system, sort of inspired by more East Asian folk tales and religious ideas, is the one from Exalted, which is an old White Wolf game that maybe got resurrected a little while ago. I haven't played the new version, but there is literally a god of everything, right? There is a spirit and a god of every house and every river and every town and every city. And only a couple of them, though, have ever become powerful enough to really assert their sway over things. And these sort of seven or so universal gods are so extremely powerful, they don't really care anymore. So it's all these little gods that are around everywhere. But they don't have the problem of having to have clerics and things in the campaign.
Yeah, and this is something I want to encourage you to think about as you're building your world, because if there are these all-powerful or very powerful beings with an interest in the world, what stops them from just ruling, you know, a kingdom as a literal, you know, god king or something like that? What stops them from just like wiping their foes out? And the answer to that can be very, very interesting. Right. Actually,
it could be they don't care.
Right. I think that actually this is something that Forgotten Realms has done. One thing I do want to praise them for, because they've established through successive revisions of the lore that gods can die, and then from time to time something bad happens, like magic disappears, or they get thrown down to earth, or if they lose too many followers, they, you know, sort of like fade out and vanish and cease to exist. And so, you know, maybe it's something as simple as the more worshippers a god has, the more powerful they are. That's a perfectly elegant and interesting way, which creates a lot of cool dynamics, potentially, within your world. It could also be something like there's substantially more going on in the whatever plane the gods live on, so they don't have time or energy or attention to deal with the affairs of mortals. Or it could be like in Rich Berlew's Order of the Stick. They are interested, they just need to work through proxies.
And you could always take the sort of, there's an equal and opposing force, right? Sure, Thor could show up and destroy the frost giants attacking your village, but if he does that, the Loki will also show up.
Right.
So he doesn't want to.
The sort of like Cold War model is a good one. You know, there's the, you know, whatever prime material area is where the gods, you know, play out their planar geopolitical nonsense. But if any of them become too involved or too overt in their actions, then, you know, the opposing side will also do so. And so they need to maintain a professional distance or, you know, not be seen as giving too much favor or influencing events too directly, which, again, gives you a little bit of breathing room in terms of how your gods affect the world. But explains
our God
why...
is an indirect God. He reigns.
Yeah, and there's, of course, always the clockmaker god, distant creator of the world who set it in motion and now has no interest in affecting the ongoing function of it. But yeah, there's a lot of different ways, but I encourage you to think about who your gods are, what they care about, what their motivations are, and... It can be often that their motivations are bizarre and inscrutable. These are infinite divine beings. Maybe they care about things that mortals can't possibly understand. You know, but they should have motivations. And they should care about something if they are sentient. If it's just some sort of like unknowable divine force, then that's something else as well.
Yeah, there. And if you want to go really wacky, right, you could, speaking of that, make all of your gods, maybe if not evil, just so unknowable, they might not actually be good.
Oh, sure.
You know, it's sort of the regular trope is that, you know, sorcerers and warlocks and wizards, arcane mages are often have restrictions and things like that. It could be in your world, people don't like gods. Gods are scary. It's divine magic people are afraid of.
Well, and this is sort of like the inherent assumption of the Cthulhu mythos, and in a sense, like Warhammer 40K, is that there are, you know, infinitely powerful beings or, you know, great powerful forces, but messing with them at all is dangerous, and they are all, like, alien and awful and, you know, not friendly. And if mortals become involved, then they're inherently at risk, which is tricky when the game like D&D involves the use of magic consistently, but can be fun and interesting.
One of our mantras in the world building is we said we are going to world build by example, because we could certainly talk all day about this in the abstract.
Sure.
But it's more interesting and we hope more useful when we get down to what trying to work through it through actual worlds.
I agree. And before we get to that, sorry, there's one thing wanted to... No, it's okay. This is good. Let's. I want our bridge to be... I'd like to come up with a couple of examples from fantasy that we think are particularly interesting.
Ooh, let's make God.
Different types of perceptions of the divine that I think are unique and interesting and worth drawing inspiration from. Matt, does anything...
Build-A-Bear workshop, but for gods.
Does anything jump to mind that you've read or watched that you particularly liked or thought that was unique and valuable and interesting in terms of gods and the divine and faith?
Two old tropes that I always are interested in going back to is, do you remember the original series Star Trek episode, Who Mourns for Adonis?
Yeah, I think so.
It's the one where the Greek gods are actually just really powerful aliens.
Oh,
but
yes.
They also need worshippers.
Well, and this is the entire conceit of the Stargate series, which started out super wacky and goofy, but as it dragged on to 10 seasons...
It became so serious. It was never wacky and goofy again.
Yeah. I there was like a sweet spot in the middle where I think they like really nailed like a little bit of campiness, but also like this is how this would work. Which I thought was really neat from and interesting from in a sci-fi show, and I think they did a pretty good job of, because it got a little like high fantasy, you know, people kept like ascending to like beings of pure energy and then de-ascending, and I think that's a very interesting way to do that. It could be, this is sort of like a journey to the
barrier. I did that once after I drank the Tom Brady recommended amount of water per day for a week. It's half your body weight in ounces. So, you know, 90 ounces of water a day. It's great.
This could be an interesting sort of like take on that old D&D trope where there are aliens, you know, Journey to the Barrier Peaks type stuff. Like maybe your gods are actually aliens or just powerful beings from beyond your planet. That's always, I agree with Matt. That's always a fun trope. It's a little bit of a overdone at this point, but it's still like kind of a fun and cool idea. And it's different than just like, it's a pantheon, you know?
I guess if I had to pick one from history, so Gnostic beliefs from all the various like heresies of early Christianity are always really wacky and weird. And there's definitely room for a polytheistic pantheon through the different emanations of God and all that kind of shit.
I'm glad you brought this up because this is something that I have leaned on heavily in all of my world building because I think it's so interesting and unique and presents a different feel than a lot of what you get in most fantasy. I think it's super interesting stuff. It's very weird and hard to like sort of like wrap your head around, but that's what makes it fun. I'm trying to think of something specific that I liked. I actually like George R. R. Martin's. I really like actually the faith in Game of Thrones a lot because it is sort of a mix of real and not real. And when somebody actually does something that appears to be, you know, there appears to be only like one actual faith that works, and it's evil and nightmarish and and horrifying. I mean, it's sort of unsubtle what he's doing there, but I think it's like particularly well done, much the same way that he's approached magic in Game of Thrones.
It's as Jon Snow said, meat is proof that the Lord of Darkness, the Great Other, hates us and wants us to die.
Yeah, But yeah, there's a lot of, I would say that probably like the more boring ones are the things like, sorry to drag your memory through the mud, Robert Jordan, but you know, the Wheel of Time sort of concept of faith is pretty, I mean, it's pretty bleh, and there's just a literal bad guy named Shaitan and a generic, like, is there even like, there's just like a good force.
Yeah, there's the creator. There's the creator. But he doesn't do stuff.
He doesn't do anything.
But maybe he does.
But maybe he does. That's the thing. Like, it's very poorly established, like, what that is. Actually, I'm failing to come up with a lot of, like, particularly good examples. I think it's interesting. A lot of fantasy properties specifically avoid dealing with questions of faith, I think, because of not wanting to bring up, like, any sort of like real world comparisons or.
Well, have you read, I think one that does it interestingly that's been maybe copied ad nauseum is Louis McMaster Bujold, the Paladin of Souls.
Oh, I haven't. No.
So, I mean, her faith is, and the gods are very central, but it's that sort of standard pantheon that I think George R. R. Martin copied for his new gods. You know, there are five gods, five fingers on the hand, the father, the mother, the warrior, the maiden, and the bastard, right?
Excellent choices, yeah.
One interesting thing you can do with faiths like this, where there's just sort of one faith, is you can always say, well, if these people over here or this other species of humanoids worships a god, it's just a different version of the father, right? They call him the great judge or the first orc, but he's just the father. And then you could have like faith schisms, right? There are people who believe there's only one correct interpretation, then there are universalists. There are, I think, in the Paladin of Souls series, there's a group of people who deny the divinity of the bastard. So they make the holy sign by hiding their thumb in their fist because that's his finger. You know,
you say there's only this many actual gods, but each culture or each society or each you know, fantasy race has their own idea of what that means. But yeah, okay, so sorry, this is enough of a tangent. Let's
get down.
Let's learn by doing. Matt, do you want to start with what you were talking about? I know you came with some things you were working through, so do you want to lead?
Oh, man. So this one, and I really, at our last world building episode, you're like, and our next topic is the gods. I'm like, God damn it. Like, everything else is going so well. But this is the, like, one thing I'm struggling with. So, quick overview. The world I'm working on building, we're calling it right now Wild Space. And it's basically a sort of a more comprehensive spelljammer setting that isn't just created to link different worlds, but have new worlds of its own and take a high adventure, exploration, and intergalactic politics to D&D. The gods. One thing I thought I would like to explore that hasn't been done very often is religions. I think religions might be more interesting than actual gods. And based on our earlier discussion, here's the dichotomy I'm considering for my world. One, the gods can exist and gods are real, but they're often beings that live on our plane of reality in one specific location, and they're very local, and they're often very petty and scary, right? Like Apollo in that episode of Star Trek,
right,
or a giant Cthulhu monster, right? They're weird and scary. Religions are a lot more safer. Normal people study religions. They're universal. They can be, you know, from anywhere in the galaxy, whereas gods tend to be more local. And as a cleric or a paladin, you could be tied to either. A god might be limited to the number of clerics he can support, depending on how many worshipers he or she or it has, whereas a religion is an idea or a philosophy or a force so powerful that there can be, you know, millions of clerics. And these are the big forces. So that's what I'm thinking of.
Interesting. So are the religions, do the religions themselves worship a god? Or are they more maybe something like Confucianism, like a philosophy or a life path or an ethos?
Right. Yeah, say what you want about the blood of all, Rob. At least it's an ethos.
At least it's an ethos, yeah.
So that's what I'm thinking, is the religions have a belief that, you know, really is probably impossible to confirm or deny about the underlying nature of reality or the cosmos, right? Magic can only get us so far in figuring these things out. But yeah, they're probably philosophies or ethos. And I guess this is how I came to it. I feel like I came up with one really good plot hook religion, which is the Great Becoming, which is a Borg-like entity of people that try and get you to believe that they, if they can amass enough followers, can become a living universal god. All you have to do is surrender your individuality and become part of a proto-divine hive mind. And so working from there, I'm like, well, what's on either side of the spectrum from that? Local gods that are often crazy or evil and people tend to distrust, or rational people that have traveled around the galaxy, maybe not locals who have never left their planet, and then universal forces and religions.
I like that a lot. And we talked about at the beginning that I really like, especially for a role-playing game, the idea of having faith derived from commitment to a goal or an ethos or a philosophy or an element rather than a deity. Not that there's anything wrong with that, but in terms of creating new and unique and potentially interesting conflicts, both within the party and with the world, I think that the philosophy is really, really good. It depends sort of on whether or not your players are going to like want to buy into being something like that. So I will say this for Pantheons. It is very easy. It makes it easy. It doesn't require a lot of like prep work or buy-in or a lot of like, you know, outside the box thinking. And not that necessarily a religion that follows, you know, sort of like a general faith concept does, but it's a bit more of a lift.
No one wants to be a cleric of altruism, I suppose.
Right. Sorry. Nobody wants to be a monk of a pacifist monk, a monk of silence. As fun as that was in Pathfinder to create like deeply broken builds by being a monk that didn't speak.
By
or something
not
like
talking.
That. Yeah.
Okay. Help me out here, Rob. So what are like, some good, so assuming that gods have basically from civilized space been basically purged by heroes, mm-hmm. In the past, though, of course there's some still hiding and those will make great villains, or maybe not villains, but just, interesting NPCs. What are some good forces and religions and philosophies to go with? I can start while you're thinking.
Like, I mean, I have one right to go. Do yours first.
Okay, excellent. So I already did the Great Becoming, and they're basically like the Borg villain of the campaign, though they may not all be that bad. My next one is definitely a religion of humans, right? Of humanity. Basically, there's going to be a human intergalactic empire that believes that humans are the perfect balance of all the known sentient species, and everyone else should be, you know, depending on your interpretation of this religion, purged or made subservient or enslaved to humans. Humans should rule. So I don't know what I'm going to call this yet, but some sort of Church of Humanity.
Church of Humanity sounds great to me, and it says exactly what you need. The first thing that comes to mind, and I think this actually makes substantially more sense in a fantasy or an RPG setting than it does in the real world, but a faith or an ethos of will to power. A sort of, not to get too grim, but fascist, Nietzschean, you know, Ubermenschian type thing, where the only thing that this faith values is the gathering and expression of power. And so, you know, it would be, you know, highly, highly combat based and structured, but also, you know, the more magic or wealth or whatever that you gather yourself, there's literally nothing that is wrong to do if you are making yourself or the faith more powerful. And it would make excellent villains. There, depending on how you express it, it would be an interesting player character choice. Obviously, a lot of conflict with other characters. It leaves enough open to interpretation that not everybody has to be a hyper-insane fascist, but it does leave a lot of room for, you know, potential warlords and villains and, you know, big-time enemies to pop up from. I just also think it would make a lot of sense in a setting where there's like measurable forms of power, like you have this many spells you level up to worship actual gathering of power.
Yeah. Ooh, I like that. So I'm definitely going to steal that. I might make it even more evil and make it like a Church of Randian objectivism.
That's what I was thinking. That's my first thought was just like, make it objectivism, like literal, like, yeah. Only thing that matters is you. Yeah. And yeah.
Yeah, that's a great one. And that's, you definitely always want to have some gods or religions that align with maybe some of your other factions, like a species or an empire or a kingdom, but some that are like more universal. That one's a great one that can be like more universal. I'm also thinking, and this is an interesting question here, and this may not be a religion or force or a god, but the Xeno Druid, the ultimate druid, the meta druid, I think they'll call it, the meta druid, which is basically only followed by druids and rangers, and they believe that the galaxy itself is one super organism.
So this aligns with something that I was thinking of. I was thinking that you might want a sort of like a faith of balance, or like a Taoist religion that sees sort of a dedicates itself to bringing all things into harmony, whatever that means. And I love the idea that like the whole universe is like one gigantic organism, and so their devotion to nature is to sort of bring everything into alignment, which could, I think what's interesting about that is that it can create both very altruistic and benevolent followers, but also potentially, you know, even like genocidal ones.
You could have a hero or a villain. And then I think, I mean, we should, so I'm going to steal that, call them the harmonics or something like that. Then I think I'm definitely going to have a sort of unequivocally well-intentioned religion dedicated to fighting maybe not all kinds of evil, but like some types of evil.
In a fantasy setting, I think it's very good to have like a monster hunting or an evil hunt. When they're, again, in a fantasy setting, you have monsters that are literally evil. So there's actually fewer shades of gray than there are in the real world in some senses. So it makes sense to have a faith or a group of paladins or something like the Order of the Gauntlet in Forgotten Realms that exists only or exists purely in intention to fight evil or to, you know, purge monsters or to protect people from bad things.
I think the last two faiths I need is one of the themes, and we talked about this a long time ago, that I want to bring up is the sort of idea of colonialism and anti-colonialism and small fish in a big galaxy, where that the player's home sort of starting system is either newly discovered or newly unprotected, and surrounding it in many directions are these big colonizing intergalactic empires. You know, they could be elves, they could be multi-species, they could be an empire of dragons. You know, one of the themes of colonialism, and, you know, feel free to correct me if I'm wrong, is people who were colonized were very adept at taking religious ideas that came from imperial nations and making them their own, and in many times turning them back on their creators as sort of a justification for independence movements.
I think that's actually very true. And the first thing that I thought of when you mentioned this, and I want to be careful about this, but the idea that I'm coming up with is actually I'm thinking of the Ghost Dance, because the Ghost Dance, among other things, was in part a millennialist, eschatological end times sort of syncretism of indigenous faiths with a lot of what had been picked up from Christianity, and it was a deeply complicated, and I don't want to oversimplify it, but I like the idea of there sort of being a faith or a religion that exists in response to colonizers or empire or ideas that come down that has merged with or been syncretized with sort of like an indigenous faith. And there's a lot of ways to go about that. That's very, very interesting. So depending on your world, what it was like before it was exposed to the outside, there's a lot of different forms that could come up with.
I could see a ghost dance being a combination of, you know, ideas gleaned from druids who believe in this meta druid, a meta galaxy, plus the sort of new ideas from the invaders. So it's, you know, you could have a cleric of this who is in fact fighting his fellow co-religionists because he has, you know, what he or she believes is the correct interpretation. I'm guessing this might be a religion that believes in some sort of apocalypse or end times, or maybe even just a heaven or a pure land or something like that.
Yeah, I think it makes sense to have it. It's either looking toward a apocalyptic event that will either end the galaxy or transform it, you know, some sort of literally an apocalypse, a rapture or something like that, and is either working towards it or anticipating it or encouraging it to happen. And this doesn't have to be necessarily like a nihilistic or violent or, you know, destructive inherently, but it is, you know, something that is opposed to or working against a lot of the established religions and faiths and the order of things.
And I mean, those are, I think, a good number, at least, to get started of forces.
I have one other idea.
Oh, please, I need more.
And you can tell me if this fits with your world, but given that it's a spelljammer-ish type setting, that I think it would make sense there to be a group of, we'll just call them technocrats, for lack of a better idea, people who worship the advanced...
The god of progress.
Yeah, worship progress, worship... artifice, not technology, because it's a fantasy setting, but they worship artificers, they worship advance of magical knowledge or magical prowess, you know, the creation of new and better, of progress, actually, I think is the best way to put that, yeah.
If I wanted to add a wrinkle, I could take this Church of Humanity and add in some old, which believes in, let's say it believes in progress and advancement, but there's an older or a side interpretation that basically the humans that are using it are sort of grafting on this. So you could have people who are part of this religion and they're like, oh, we reject the human supremacist part of this.
Oh, I like that. That's a very interesting wrinkle.
Yeah. Just for this.
So there's either an older faith or an offshoot that relates to the Church of Humanity, but has similar goals, but different interpretations of the same central ideas or central text. I think that's good. I think that's interesting.
The only other thing I was considering, and thanks for that, Rob, is so it's a game set in space and you hop around to different planets. I've got to find some way to work in astrology and the Zodiac. So the Zodiac could easily be a religion of destiny and foretelling of people believe that the universe works in some sort of predestined way. So it could just be one more faith philosophy that clerics, if they believe in and are chosen by and purely embody this belief, can draw their power on. Or it could be something that, is not considered a religion. It's just the mechanism of the cosmos. Maybe, for example, bardic magic relates to the music of the spheres and the turning of the zodiac. So I'm not sure if I'm going to make that a religion yet or keep it as, you know, something any character could take. For example, at character creation, you could be chosen by your sign, and it could have some mechanical benefit. Could be a feat or something.
Interesting. I don't know.
Do you think it works better as a religion or something outside?
I think it works
a
great as a sort of like something underlying the rest of it. A little bit like how dragon marks work in Eberron is something that other people can draw power from. It doesn't necessarily have to be its own faith. It can relate as little or as much to other faiths as it makes sense for them. I think it's a good sort of like underlying mechanic for the world itself or for the galaxy itself, in a sense.
All right, so there was, I think, brainstorming gods and religion and faith in wild space. We've got some cool and interesting faiths that will lead to adventures, and we've also made room for kind of traditional gods in an usually a more antagonistic spot in the campaign. So if a player showed up at my campaign is like, I want to be a cleric of Thor, I would be totally okay with that. I would be like, you're from the shitty planet of Vikings, and you worship a very powerful being that you call Thor. He's probably an ancient alien. He has a very limited worship, but if you can spread the gospel of Thor to other planets, he can become more powerful. People aren't gonna like you, but you can be a cleric of Thor.
Okay.
Take a quick break and talk about your ideas?
Yeah, I've got some questions about magic, which we'll touch on our other bit for this podcast. Let's take a quick break.
Okay.
You can run on for a long time. Run on for a long time. Run on for a long time. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Sooner or later, gotta cut you down. Go tell that long-tongued liar. Go and tell that midnight rider.
So which world are you going to be talking about? New one or Thunder on the Steppe?
A new one. If we have time, I'd like to touch on some of the stuff on Thunder on the Steppe. But there's some through lines, so hopefully we can talk about my new homebrew and deal with some of the same issues. But my newest homebrew is a lot more nascent than Matt's is. It is still very, very much in the planning stages. And it doesn't even have a real name yet, at least not one that I'm willing to share because it'll give too much away. But it sort of stems from my recent interest, and we talked about this a bit early on, in Gnosticism and in European mysticism and alchemy and a lot of that interesting weirdness, especially in the 15th, 16th, and 17th centuries. When you get a lot of this exploration into really bizarre mystical ideas, when things like the Corpus Hermeticum and other things are unearthed and revisited, and there's some non-church approved forays into other types of examining faith and ideas and the ways of the universe. And
Quietism.
I wanted to... Yeah, well, and also, as Matt mentioned before, a lot of really weird but also interesting heresies. And
my favorite are the like monks and nuns who are just really really horny for God.
Yeah, horny for God.
I'm joking a little bit, but they wrote really beautiful things.
They did. The thing is, like, some of the best poetry is from people who are really like they want to do sex with God. And you know what? More power to them, you know? Whatever you believe, man.
Wait, I'm going to steal that as another religion for my thing.
That's actually a good idea. By the way.
A religion that wants to... Oh, you want to become God? No, we want to fuck God.
Wasn't this a plot point in the Da Vinci Code? Wasn't that like the whole like thing of the Priory of Zion or whatever it was that they wanted?
I have never seen or read the Da Vinci Code.
Anyway.
Sorry, I'm a bad nerd. I thought they want to fuck the like descendant of Jesus or something, right?
I'm trying, there was a definitely like a ritual sex scene in the beginning that I don't remember what it was about. But
aren't we like really glad we're like past the Da Vinci Code era where everyone was really obsessed with,
I'm extremely glad. And also like we're beyond like holy blood, holy grail business. Though that sort of relates, and one really inspiration for me was, the very excellent, Name of the Rose by, Umberto Eco, right, of course. A really, really excellent book about literature and monks and the Middle Ages and weird mysticism and heresies. Excellent, excellent book, but one that I loved reading and gave me a lot of ideas for this. So I wanted to create a world where alchemy was real, and again, this is like not a super like complicated like big stretch for D&D, but where it sort of like underpinned a lot of the magic, a little bit like how, and a lot of the economy and the functioning of the world, a little bit how Eberron functions as if magic were real and it were used for things like elevators and ships and things like that. And so,
going full all magic has an alchemical basis?
No. And so that's where I'm a little bit stuck, because I don't want Well, here's what I've got so far. So let me tell you what I'm working with and where I'm a bit stuck. Because the idea that I have is that I'm obviously going to try to explore some questions of colonialism, because that's what we're all working in a post-colonial world now, and I have a lot of thoughts about it, and I don't think it's possible to sort of do any sort of like early modern medieval fantasy without touching on this a bit. So I have this idea that there's sort of a generic trade league, right? And they've got a city set up in the New World, where they the idea is that this is where all of the cinnabar is mined, and it goes through and it's turned into quicksilver, where it is shipped back to the old continent and is used to fuel
so it's
all
like,
sorts.
What if the Venetians or Genoese colonized America?
Something like that. The idea I actually have is it's the Caledonian League, so it's a bit like what if the Darien scheme succeeded, but you know, they were mining quicksilver instead of something like that.
The Scots, they are really bad at colonialism.
They're real bad. God,
the point is everyone was really bad at colonialism.
Everyone was real bad.
Until
the Scots,
they got machine
the Scots
guns.
Failed so much more miserably than everybody else. You know, it led directly to the union with England. It's just like, in terms of like countrywide national failures, they recovered just fine, but you know, real bad. Anyway, so the idea is that there's this wealthy and eclectic and multicultural city on the coast of a new world with powerful and significant, you know, indigenous cultures who have not been conquered. And so there are several different, and that stuff we'll talk about later. That's just sort of like the core.
Right. We're talking gods and magic.
Gods and magic. The magic that I want to talk about, so there are several traditions of magic, the idea that I'm working with. So there's, of course, alchemical magic. And I would say that, yes, there is a way for all magic, all arcane magic, right, to be accomplished through the use of alchemy. And the working idea for that I have is that, and this is tricky because there's already a material cost for everything in D&D. It's just kind of handmade.
Right. You can easily just house rule. There is no such thing as arcane focuses in my game. You have to use a material component pouch
right.
for everything.
And the idea I have is that you can just sort of like burn gold or quicksilver in place of the material pouch. So
there's one component that is the universal
right.
material.
Exactly.
That's very alchemical.
It is.
Sought after because if you just use a drop of it, you don't have to go collect fucking bat guano.
That's right.
If you decide to prepare fireball that day.
And the choice that you would have to make is that would be more expensive. And so what I don't want to do is create a whole bunch of extra rules or bookkeeping. So that's the idea I have. I'm still working on like the fine tuning, so it doesn't involve a lot of extra work. I also
right.
want
players
there to be
want to have to make players keep track of components.
Right.
But I like where you're going. You could easily make it. It's not unreasonable to ask players to keep track of two or three types of components.
Exactly.
Or even maybe eight, one for each school of magic.
Exactly. So this is just the general idea I have for that type of magic.
I'm already going off the rails here. 10
okay,
is obviously illusion. let's see. Silver, conjuration,
right.
gold, evocation, divination. Okay, sorry.
There's three other traditions, like magical traditions that you can draw from. There's, of course, faith. And this is where I'm also like trying to explore some of that Gnosticism, that there's a sort of like a general over God or, you know, all soul type thing. And that everybody has sort of like a different interpretation of how to worship that. And there was sort of a major schism in the old world over that. And I'm sort of modeling it after like a couple of different traditions, Catharism and whichever one sort of placed Mary at a higher
right.
a level than other traditional Catholic or Christian faiths.
You can always have a no fuck sack.
The no fuck sack. And the idea is that...
So Rob, this is a really great idea. And just to continue a second, but a really great idea because... One of the problems in D&D, at least in the current edition, is arcane and divine magic, right? What really sets them apart, right? And you got to kind of think about that. And you've basically made arcane magic incredibly material, right? You just need these components and a set of spells and things like that. Divine magic believes in anti-materialism, Gnosticism, right? The material world is evil and a lie, and it's the spiritual world.
So, and I do, I am thinking there's literally a demiurge or a belief in a demiurge. And so the people who are of faith, if you're a cleric or a paladin, you believe in a you are literally opposed to the material world.
Demigorgon for you.
Demigorgon. And so this can take different forms. Like some Gnostic sects involved, you know, flagellation and dancing or different types of asceticism. So maybe there could be a no fuck sect. Maybe there could be a lot of fucking sect, you know, different ways of eschewing the flesh or.
So, every cleric or paladin maybe has some kind of special vow that is essentially a role-playing opportunity for that character.
And so my, again, this is the my job of tweaking as this goes on, is to make sure that there's in there needs to be DM fiat, but I don't want to make it too much work or too much, because this is D&D and you want there to be sort of like some guardrails so that the DM doesn't have to make too many decisions or have to rule in a way that might upset a player, but give them some structure.
Yeah, one thing we should say about the Dungeons & Dragons magic system is people are always trying to tweak it and change it and stuff like that. You may be dissatisfied with it, but it works really well.
The idea
I've played tons of role-playing games that have open-ended magic systems where you have a skill for illusion or fire magic or something, and you roll checks and you try and do it. One of the great things about D&D is spells have sort of set formulae and set things they do. It makes the game go quickly. It keeps spellcasters in line with other types of adventurers. It's easy for players to wrap their head around.
And I play in a Burning Wheel game, which I love, and it's a lot of fun. But the magic system in that is incredibly complicated and unreliable. And it means every time somebody casts a spell or tries to, like, you know, use their faith, it's always an event, which is one way of going about it. But D&D is structured in such a way that you will be casting spells with quite a lot of frequency. And so you don't want every single spell cast to involve a bunch of extra rolling.
Right. Only mess with this at your own peril.
So, and then there's two other traditions, which I'm thinking about. And one is, again, related to faith. It is I'm going to call it like a nature or a druidic tradition, which a little bit like what you were talking about is related.
Well, you got to find a place for druids or rangers in your world.
Right, is related to the cycle of the sun, possibly the function of the stars. And the idea I have, or the astrology, right, the position of the stars or the celestial bodies. And again, I don't want to limit anyone's playing or like say, oh, you can only cast these spells when it's sunny outside or these spells when Mercury is in the house of whatever. But it would be interesting, I think, to place some limitations on druidic or nature magic that, you know, requires the player to ask, what's the weather like? Or something like that. And the issue is not doing that. The issue is doing it in a way that is not burdensome or annoying for the players involved.
Well, here's an idea, is you basically roll up some tables that will generate you a random star chart. Or, you know, there are websites that do this, but instead of making it restrictions on what you can cast, right? Maybe it's, you know, druidicism in my mind is always associated with taboos, right? Maybe it's something you can't do, right? Maybe there's a specific word you can't say during that day, or maybe you can't make them things that are not mechanical hindrances, but role-playing hindrances.
That's a great idea. And that worked for arcane magic in previous editions of D&D, or it was mechanical, but you know, you would have an opposition to school or something like that. And it can be just as simple as this is what your druidic tradition doesn't like. This is what, you know,
if you're of the druidic tradition of, let's say, Mars, you know, you can't turn into an animal that doesn't have a strong attack. Right. And these are the ones are banned. It doesn't change anything, right? You can still turn into a bird. You're just a hawk instead of a crow.
Right. And if you're a a shaman of the sun, you know, your certain of your spells will take a certain, you know, manifest in a certain way, or possibly have like a slightly different effect or something like that. That's good.
And
that
Rob, can be... if you want to, I don't want to get too crazy, but following Brandon Sanderson's third law of magic in a world building, which is something we didn't talk about,
but it's an interesting read.
If you want to look it up, we'll put a link in it, is expand and connect when possible. So, Rob, there are 7 traditional alchemical planets, or sorry, astrological planets, right? Sun, Moon, Mercury, Venus, Mars, Saturn, and Jupiter. There are also, I think, 7 traditional alchemical substances, which conveniently have the same sign. So the stars, the planets, relate to Druidism. The alchemical substances relate to arcane magic. And then for divine magic, they could be the 7 emanations of the true God. Now, I know in Gnosticism, there's like 30 or something like
sure,
that. But you could reduce it down
to 7.
There's
7.
Or you could make divine magic different, right? It doesn't have to follow the same schema because it
No, but I like this idea. And the very least I can do is sort of like pull up these charts, take a look, draw some connections and see what makes sense. So there's one last thing I want to explore with you, and we talked about this a bit elsewhere, but I'm thinking there's like one last, there's sort of an old faith, right? There's one last, you know...
Right. How are you going to fit in sorcerers, warlocks?
Right.
How are you
going to
fit in
And this is, I was thinking it's going to be blood or flesh related. And so we talked about, you don't want to have people like pay an HP cost. Humorous. You don't want people to pay an HP cost to cast things that gets difficult to balance and is a problem. But I want this like last tradition to be sort of based on a very like material, mechanical, but sort of creepy.
It's internal as opposed
internal,
to external.
Yeah. A reliance on actual like lifeblood. And it could just be you use like the blood of animals or something like that, or you something like that. But that's what I want sort of like the last tradition to be, sort of a precursor to alchemy before, you know, people figured out how to use material components instead.
Ooh. Okay, right. It's seen by the people of the world as like backwards, inefficient, or maybe just evil.
Oh, yeah. Potentially all of the above, depending on, yeah, where you come from, what your perception is.
This makes me think of one thing, and maybe not to get too off topic, but, you know, small mechanical changes to the way the rules work can really help your players embrace the world, right? Dungeons & Dragons 5th edition has something called rituals, right? People can cast without expending spell slots. To represent the progress and triumph of arcane magic, you could say anyone who knows a ritual and wants to spend 50 gold on the ritual book and writing it down can cast a ritual. Essentially, every player starts with the ritual caster feat, right?
Now, if you're
a cleric, one of your vows in Gnosticism would be you would never cast an arcane ritual, right?
Right.
That requires alchemical components. And then this, you could pick up feats, right? You're born under a bad sign. This gives you some minor druidic powers. You could pick up a feat, or if you have a vow, even if you're not a cleric, you might have a minor divine power. And then back to where we were on internal magic, on blood magic, on old magic. So we still have warlocks and sorcerers, right?
Mm-hmm.
Sorcerers have always been based on, like, you've inherited blood of some sort of supernatural creature or
right.
experiment. Warlock is about forging a pact with a powerful being.
Mm-hmm.
I think both of those could be incorporated into this.
Yeah, I think so too. I mean, I've got an idea for, you know, one group of powerful vampire lords.
They're also both charisma based.
Which could be somebody, some group that is potentially powerful enough to be a patron for a warlock or a bloodline for a sorcerer. I haven't thought this through yet, but there's plenty of other things that I could seed that are either gone or long forgotten that would be the source of power for warlocks or sorcerers or anybody who wants to be an adherent of the old faith or the blood magic.
Now,
yeah.
Back to your cost in blood magic, right? If we're going off old European scientific beliefs, right, you could go to the humors. If you draw your magic from blood. As you lose blood, you become less sanguine, right? Which means you're less... I forget my humor theory.
I do too. I can never keep track of it, yeah.
Right, so obviously this might... you'd be less positive. You'd be less optimistic and cheery. So this is, again, a cost for players that's a role-playing cost that they would have to buy into. Basically, every time you cast a spell, you get sad. But you could pick a different humor that powers your magic. And basically, the more spells you cast, the happier you get, the more energetic you get.
It's like doing,
I don't know, cocaine or something. Actually, yeah. Explain to your players in terms of different drugs, right?
If you're a blood
mage, every time you cast a spell, the higher you get. It's like
I'd have to go back to humor's theory, but this is a really interesting idea that different types of spells drain your humors or imbalance your humors. Ooh, this is interesting.
Right. It imbalances your humors. So that's what sorcerers have. Maybe they were born with just a special humor power. Warlocks, maybe there's a creature or a type of creature associated with each humor. Vampires for blood that can grant them magic by forging a pact with them.
Yeah, I have to go back to like... Again, I also can never remember what the humors actually are, but there's definitely like some interesting...
Black bile, yellow bile, phlegm. You could always make
blood.
Up your own set of humors.
Yeah, that's true.
If you want to stick also, with your scheme of seven, you could come up with seven humors.
I want to mention something to
masculine
listeners.
Humor.
Listen, this is a hobby horse of mine and something that is fun and interesting to me. I want to make it clear that this is not the best place to start if you were trying to create something that is fun for your players.
Yeah, absolutely. And you don't have to think about any of those things. You don't actually have to be like, well, why are there bards, right? Also, Rob, in your world, where do bards fit? You don't have to come up with a schema for different spell casting or magic or how it works.
This is a fun exercise for me, and I think that like once I finish it, once I have thought through, for example, where bards come from, I have a couple of ideas about that. But that when you know, if it helps you run a game, and if it helps you run a better game, that's good. I have played in games with people where they were particularly interested in little bits of things like this. Like, I played in a game with somebody who was very into different types of currency. That ended up not being very interesting for the actual players. And so I'm doing this now, and I hope that like once I have it done, I can like go back and look, okay, how will this be fun for my players? How will this create a better and more interesting game? But I don't want you to listen to this and think that you need to be referencing the Corpus Hermeticum or any sorts of texts, you know, to like create all these different connections. That is completely not necessary to world building. You can go as simple or as complicated as you like. This is just me, a 32-year-old man who read too many books and has a lot of thoughts about weird European mysticism and is looking for an outlet. So don't necessarily use this as a model. I hope that you found some of what we talked about interesting, but remember that it's really about what's interesting for you and allows you to keep running a game and stay engaged, but also what your players are going to find interesting.
Right. It doesn't have to be the focus of your game. For example, in Wild Space, right, I have decided there are five kinds of magic, right? Arcane, divine, primal, psionic, and harmonic, the magic of bards. Does it matter how you access your magic? Yeah, it does for your player character, but you know, they all end up the same. There's no mechanical effect. It doesn't have too much impact on the world, though some factions lean on one type of magic more than another, right? It's not a big deal.
Yeah, and I will say that if you're excited about something, your players are going to be excited about something. So, you know, feel free to include whatever little bit of lore or hobby horse or little thing that you're interested in as much as you like. But make sure to talk to your players and communicate to them what you're interested in and what you're trying to accomplish with your homebrew.
Right. And I think the important thing, right, that Rob just mentioned is back to your players, right?
Yeah.
You can build a really complicated magic system that does all sorts of cool things. But the important thing for players is what it means for them, right? Does being a cleric mean you were chosen by the gods and there's nothing you can do about it? Or does being a cleric mean that you have faith in this god to an utmost holy degree? or that you are just basically a living embodiment of that god, right? Tell them what it means for them to be X spellcasting magic class or X type of magic, and that will be the most interesting part. You can do the other stuff in the background, but make sure to come back to this.
Yeah. I could literally talk about this all day, but I think we're close to at time, so
right.
We may absolutely revisit this again, but I think we talked a lot about what we said we're going to talk about, which is faith and magic, and hopefully gave you all a bunch of interesting ideas.
Two things, Rob. One, what do you think we should talk about? So again, so people can follow along, what do you think should be our next subject?
I think it should be politics and government.
Factions.
Politics, governance.
Power.
Power. Yep.
Yep.
The material. Yeah. This
is where exactly where I was going. And then the second thing, Rob, is, we can cut this out if we don't have time, but we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 or so campaign Bibles that listeners have sent in. If we have time, we should briefly talk about some of the cool things that listeners have sent us.
We should do that. I would like to, we can cut this out. Why don't we do a mini episode this time or sometime this week, Matt? Let's do a little like
a 20 minutes
where we thank the people who wrote right. in and we cool. talk a bit about that. I think
I've got notes on all their stuff. All right.
I did look through them, but I'd like to actually give them a bit more attention. And that would be a fun like bonus content. Just like something okay. short.
So stay tuned for an extra bonus episode this week where we talk about some of the campaign ideas that you have sent us. If you enjoyed this episode and want to keep following along all semester as we work more on world building, send us your ideas at whatever stage you have in them.
Yeah, and if you have any thoughts about faith or magic that we didn't cover or if you have other questions, absolutely let us know. Write us at dmofnone@gmail.com. Add us on Twitter @dmofnone. We're very interested in this. We love world building. We want to help you come up with your own homebrew ideas. So if you have requests or thoughts, anything you want us to cover, absolutely let us know, and we will definitely get to it. Any final thoughts,
thanks
Matt?
For listening. What's your favorite hymn from growing up, Rob?
not going to answer this question. It's obviously "A Mighty Forces Is Our God," Matt.
Yeah, it's so powerful.
So powerful.
So the one that always stuck with me that our religious establishment sang every Sunday was, "I'm so glad you're a part of the family of God. Oh, you've been washed in the fountain."
Thanks for the reminder. Okay.
Anyway.
All right, everyone. Thanks for listening, everyone. Have a great week, and we'll see you all next time.
And we can say it together this time.
Keep rolling them dice. We'll practice it next time.
It was good.